Mays. Dr. Mays is a Black and Saginaw Chippewa scholar of Afro-Indigenous studies, urban studies, and Indigenous popular culture. He is an assistant professor in the Department of African American Studies, American Indian Studies, and the Department of History at UCLA. That is a big load. He's also the author of one of my favorite books, Hip Hop Beats, Indigenous Rhymes, Modernity and Hip Hop in Indigenous North America, which is SUNY Press from 2018, and the forthcoming An Afro-Indigenous History of the United States that'll be coming out from Beacon Press in November, as well as the forthcoming City of Dispossessions, African Americans, Indigenous Peoples, and the Creation of Modern Detroit, which will be coming out from University of Pennsylvania Press in 2022. Dr. Mays has written for numerous public venues, including the Washington Post and the iconic hip hop magazine Source. So please join me in welcoming him for his talk, Hip Hop as Sacred Medicine, Thoughts on Bougie Natives, Indigenous Rap Music, and Indian Popular Culture. Welcome.
Thank you very much for the introduction. And I know we're in Zoom University and people are so tired of being on Zoom, as am I, but I really appreciate it. I want to acknowledge and thank you all for showing up and participating. It never gets old talking to people, and it means a great deal to me. So I'm always very humbled to participate and build with y'all. I don't talk at people, I talk with people. I grew up in a Black church and there was always call and response. So I'm more of on the heathen side of things now, I suppose, but I always appreciate the conversation with people. So I'm looking forward to the Q&A. And I also want to second that I met Mare in Oaxaca while I was down there, and Mare is so dope. The most fantastic Indigenous feminist, and I remember talking to her, and there was some great dialogue, like her the Black feminist influence also on her education. It might not come up at some point, but just in talking to her is like pretty phenomenal. So I just want to acknowledge that. So I'm going to share my screen, and as many times as I've done these through teaching, Zoom is always, there's always some glitch that is always my fault alone. And lastly, I have a cat and a dog. Sometimes either one of them start tripping, so just please bear with me. I'll try to just ignore them, but sometimes they do the most. So I'll just get into it. So this is the title, and I'm just like working through some thoughts here too. And I'm always working through thoughts. So this is what I mean by building. So the questions, as they say, and you see this quote from Fanon on the right. It's a little bit hard to see on the screen, but the questions that I have are, what is Indigenous popular culture? What are the benefits and limits of popular culture for a host of things? And what does all of this have to do with sovereignty, Indigenous sovereignty, of course, in particular? So I want to go back to some of the elements of hip hop and make a particular argument, and something that I've been thinking through even since writing the Indigenous hip hop book. So I want to make the argument that hip hop in its original form, in its formation, is a form of Indigenous culture, right? And what do I mean by that? I'm not doing the weird Hotep thing that some people use and saying that Black people are the original Native people, that's Native erasure, etc. But there are forms of what scholars have called Black indigeneity. And you typically, when people use this phrase, they're referring to how African Americans or people of African descent are claiming to be the indigenous peoples of a particular place and therefore erasing native peoples from that particular land. But I want to flip that on its head and think about forms of culture, popular culture, folk culture, etc., and how they perpetuate ideas of African diasporic cultures, right? So if we consider just way back in time, the enslaved Africans who were kidnapped from the African continent, what we often do is erase their indigenous roots, right? And so we have to ask ourselves, when did those Africans kidnapped from the continent? Because they had their own indigenous cultures, languages, etc. I don't think there's an argument there. But we have to ask the question, when did they lose their indigeneity? Right, because we turn them into chattel slavery, we turn them into Black people. Right, and so I would propose here that there are certain cultural elements, at least in the realm of culture, that continue to persist, spirituality as well, as it relates to again African forms of culture. Right, they're not always easily defined, so well described, etc. But as Sylvia Winter told us, like when she's talking about the plot in the plantation, this sort of thing, or these things sort of emerge. So some of the modes are of hip hop elements. So MCing, it's really just Black English to the max. And I don't care if you're rapping in indigenous language, Japanese trap music, which is odd, but pretty cool. I've heard German rap music, whatever. You're still using forms of Black English, right? In the rhyme schemes and even the sound. So if you remember Black English, it's not the linguistics, but the style in which you're actually saying something. And hip hop, of course, has gone around the world. And so too, therefore, has African-American culture, African diaspora culture more specifically. The other thing is DJing, the sonic forms of call and response that exist within the music. Right. I mean, it happens, of course, there are things overlap within with the MCs as well as with through the sonic sounds for the DJ. Break dancing is always in some form of a circle and circular formations of embodied movement. Right. The body and movement and dance are both remain on the continent, certainly exists within the diaspora, but also of course exists within hip hop culture. Graffiti, the visual aesthetics, the writing, the, as I like to call it, the African diasporic expression of self, people, and community, right? These things still exist in a variety of forms, a literacy, if you will. Consciousness of knowledge, self, community, and of course with that, activism is a major part. People create protest music, which is a significant part of hip hop. And also style and aesthetics, so flashy clothing, bling bling. I mean, bling bling is a word like just created within the context of hip hop culture. And you see this now in another way, which I'll sort of gesture towards later in a video, of what I call native bling, the combination of powwow culture and the use of street culture and hip hop with the big medallions that you see a lot of people doing. And one of my other favorite artists, Sacramento Knox, who Kalonji mentioned earlier, will be speaking and does a great job of this across the board. So again, I just want to make this particular case. So what do I mean by Indian popular culture? I think there's a great deal of scholarship and work on visual culture, on cultural appropriation, and a host of other things. But there's still, to me, it's not always a clear definition of contemporary forms of indigenous popular culture. And I like to call it the artistic and creative representation of indigenous people's current realities and futures. It's cultural sovereignty, whether that's visual, aesthetics, what have you. Often you see people drawing on the past. They tell stories about the present and the future. So if you ever sit with an elder, and I like to bring our elders into this, they might tell a story over and over and over since you were a child to you're an adult, But the meaning changes depending on your particular circumstance at that time, right? So Native storytellers, elders, et cetera, rap artists, they might say the same thing, but it means something different. And I think we can all understand that as a hip hop, form of hip hop culture as well. You might hear the same song, and this goes, of course, across genres, but it means something very different to you, right? Depending on the state, it can tug on different emotions depending on your own state and where you are in life. That's the beauty of music as a whole. I think we all have our sad music after a breakup, our, you know, music that we love just to get in the mood to do things, but that's the power of music. It's beautiful. But it also had this other components too, right? It's gendered, that is Indian popular culture, it's racialized. I always like to do this as an Afro-Indigenous person. I am racialized as Black. I understand that. So we do have to talk about race. And yes, the unique difference between Native people and other folks is their treaty relationship with the U.S. But I also don't want to erase also those who experience racism from the res, the city, and those sort of spaces in between. So it's musical, visual, how people portray themselves and produce content on social media and other literary forms of indigenous expression of self, nation, and community. And I don't see those as separate, I see those as linked. That is self, nation, and community. The other thing is it's not bound only by the obsessive conversation centered on cultural appropriation. And I use the word obsessive intentionally. Cultural appropriation is a problem, right? But Native creatives use a host of things to not only focus solely on cultural appropriation, right? People are worried about the future. And in the aftermath of what I like to call of the settler colonialism and white supremacy, and I hope we all agree on this call that there should be an aftermath. But what kind of world do we want to live in when we have people who are stolen and their descendants who continue to exist on this land, right? We have to imagine some futures outside of settler colonialism and white supremacy. I don't want to live under these conditions, and I think most of us don't want those conditions either. And many of the, right? And many of the protests, of course, that have been happening for centuries now, for centuries have been to resist settler colonialism and white supremacy in the US Democratic Project. It's been fundamental to Black and Indigenous struggles. And I wanna put this last plug in. I'm gonna offer some critiques. I'm gonna use individuals, but I'm not hating on the individuals. My analysis is always structural, so don't go back and tell people, Kyle was hating on you, he said your work is trash, not what I'm doing here. All right, y'all with me there? See, this is why we need a live audience. You get the call and response there. See some of the hands, though. That's cool. So I'm going to play this particular song, Bougie Natives. And I want you to think about commodities, fetishism of commodities, and class. Right? I think one of the things we don't talk enough about in Native communities is class and the production of commodities within popular culture. All right, so let me do a new share. Y'all can hear this okay?
Nope.
Also can't see it.
Well, I did share. I knew there was something. There's always something. Hold on. Let me try this again. Do you see it now?
Yes.
Can you hear it? Just also, this video is funny too in some way. So do laugh. I know sometimes people just enjoy yourself. Mm-hmm.
my knowledge and my bread. We them bougie natives. New city, new sweet grass, new sage. We them bougie natives. Can holler at my name. Look, Snow Goonie from the boonies. Not the type you see in movies. Felt the spirit living through me since I was a puny dookie. Nietzsche, Nietzsche, looky, looky. How I get low when I boogie. Don't mind me some goody goodies. I'm Nate and Bougie. My wifey be the wolf, and I'm the wolf that's from the sea. And she no Pocahontas, more like Buffy St. Marie. Come do your dance with me. I dip, you dip, we dip. No, it ain't blasphemy. I sip, you sip, we sip with Nisi Cut. I stand and rock with all my suit without the Wooses. Me and bro came out the womb. Nietzsche 1 and Nietzsche 2. We very indigenous people. We some VIPs. I'm a blood thicker than Ulrike Grease. Nietzsche, please sing your song. This my jam. Got my fam all going ham for the land, not the gram. Stay Benet, it's who I am. We choose copper over gold. Praise the elders. I remember what I'm told. Never turn your back on home. We them bougie natives. I got turquoise on my red. We them bougie natives. Five rings up on my fist. We them bougie natives. Big hat with the brim. We them bougie natives. Got that custom made bling. We them bougie natives. New city, new sweet grass, new sage. We them bougie natives. Pour my knowledge in my brain. We them bougie natives. New city, new sweet grass, new sage. We them bougie natives. You can holler at my name.
Hey a ho.
Hey a ho.
Can't you tell them woke? The smoke shop is closed. Can you tell your boys dope? Man, I'm spinning like I made it, and I'm smudging cause I'm broke again. Always running late, I hope the liquor store is open.
I got carvers, weavers, beaters, and designers on my team. I got braiders, hella famous, that I'm signing to my team. In my limousine, don't I look steezy? Next to my DigiQueen.
Yeah, that's my Moose McGee.
I know ballers, I know chiefs, I know riders from the east. I know educated natives down to picket in the streets. Middle fingers to police, fuck you, we come in peace. I know red skin hippies that be giving me the creeps. I know beauty, I know beach, I know savages and freaks. And I know a couple cousins even bougier than me. No, 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 ain't elite, bougie native, yes indeed. Art exhibit to the club, and we roll it 20 deep. Copper on my neck, gold on my ring. Feather on my hat, skin stitched chin. 100 warriors on my back, daily drumming when I sing. Man, there ain't no way around it. I'm a
bougie native.
I got turquoise on my red.
We them bougie natives.
Five rings up on my fist.
We them bougie natives.
Big hat with the brim.
We them bougie natives.
Got that custom made bling.
We them bougie natives.
New city, new sweet grass, new sage.
We them bougie natives.
Pour my knowledge in my brain.
We them bougie natives.
New city, new sweet grass, new sage.
We them bougie natives.
You can holler at my name.
No, there's a lot going on in there. Can y'all see the PowerPoint again? Okay. So there's so much going on in there. And it's like, it's supposed to be funny, a little bit satire. But also, if you've ever had jewelry made, or I'm not really into jewelry like that. I just had my cousin make me moxen, and they were like $400. And I remember I was like, what? I mean, I paid it, and I thought I was going to get the cousin discount, but, you know, those things don't happen. But, like, that's the things that they're talking about cost a lot of money, right? But they're engaging also in this. I like to think of it as a native version of The Great Gatsby, what they're, like, really sort of accomplishing. Not the book, but, like, the film versions and the sort of grotesque consumerism that exists. And many of those, if there are any Native folks on here in any capacity, you kind of know, like, there are those folks who have all sorts of bling, and they're blinged out all the time. And they spend thousands upon thousands of dollars doing this sort of things. But for me, it's a manifestation of settler colonial capitalism, right? And they're producing this Native content within the public sphere for consumption for others. And let me give you an example of it, another one. And again, back to the no hating thing, I'm not hating on an individual. I'm gonna show this other Can you see this? Yeah. So this is Bethany Yellowtail, who does a great job of like this sort of fashion, but just read the narrative here on the website. And again, if you buy anything, buy from a native person. Don't do the Etsy stuff. It's ugly and it looks cheap. Like, actually buy from a native person. But we are a Native American owner operated fashion brand retailer that specializes in storytelling through wearable art. And our clothing is designed in-house by Bethany Yellowtail, while the By Yellowtail Collective serves as our brand initiative to support the entrepreneurial spirit of Native American First Nations and Indigenous creators. With tradition and culture at the heart of what we do, we set out to share authentic Indigenous creativity with the world while prioritizing economic opportunities for First Peoples of Indigenous North America. And I'm not hating on this, but you see often on social media from those who are in a different class status, they're like, this is not made for us. There are really two critiques. One, that it's made for people who make a great deal of income. And two, it's just hyper consumption. And as some would say, it's made for white people who can buy expensive things in some ways. Again, I don't think there's anything wrong with this, but again, I think often we don't talk enough about consumption and class status throughout Indian country. I do think it is a particular conversation we need to really get into more and more. The other thing, of course, back to share. And there's the Nike 7. I won't get into it for lack of time, but and there's been plenty of critiques around them, but people get very sensitive about that critique. And like, I buy J's and Nikes like the rest of them, even though we probably shouldn't, because they're exploiting some child somewhere. Although we should also have cell phones as well, because that's exploiting some children, slave labor in the African continent. We'll get into that. But I like what Jared Martineau and Eric Ritzkus say here. Indigenous art occupies a unique space within settler colonialism, both as a site for articulating Indigenous resistance and resurgence, and also a creative practice that often reinscribes indigeneity within aesthetic and commodity forms that circulate in the capitalist art market, right? We can't just, because it's a Native artist, that doesn't absolve the art or the commodity from also existing under capitalism, regardless of their intent. And I think that's important to really acknowledge. I'm just gonna play this song, but really think about what sovereignty means for Native peoples, right? So the other critique people had of the By Yellowtail brand was they had voting is sacred shirts. Yeah, I think if you have the ability, one should vote. I think it's important, but I also think voting ain't gonna save us. It's not going to end white supremacy. It got Donald Trump out of office, but it's not going to end anti-blackness. I think we have known that it's not going to return land to Native people necessarily. I think history and our contemporary reality have shown that. But the next video, I remember I got a call from Vice years ago, and I hadn't seen it, but I'll play this and let you take a look at it.
I got some natives and here's what they telling me. They'd rather be selling D or committing some felonies than be out to this praying. Cause to them that be hella weak, cause we should beat them cats who did this shit to us until they bleed. Fell asleep with the wheel from here on, smoking weed and pills, and everybody else are praying hope for people we should kill. Strength is kept as a secret, cause people they ain't really doubt us. Sing and dance of power now and then keep it up in the houses. What you afraid of? Our natives are dying slow, so scared we hit the easy. is targeting fodder wrong, but go ahead and come after me, cause I'm after them. But first, go out to look around and see what's still happening, cause I can't watch these kids die and then lie like I give a fuck and not do a fucking thing but lie down like I giving up. So get a gun if you ready, be gripping on the machete. For anybody involved, we got a problem, forgetting where you at.
Where you motherfuckers been? We on the front lines, walking with the dead. Where you motherfuckers been? We on the front lines, walking with the dead. Kill them all. Kill them all. Kill them, kill them all. Kill them all.
We stay running, gunning, bucking for the struggle, scrapping for our dignity, till we bloody up these knuckles. Our protectors got power flowing like an ancient stream. Yeah, they be ghosting violators like it's the fucking routine. Now this savage path to freedom might be seeming extreme, but I ain't losing one more soul to the boozer amphetamine. See, when I was a youngster, almost lost my fucking mind. Didn't recognize my purpose, didn't value this life. Propaganda almost had me convinced I was worthless. But if I kill myself, I'd just be doing them a service. We can never live free while this land remains stolen. Concrete muffles the earth, so it's like her breath she be holding. We can't breathe until she breathes, so you know how we be rolling. Civilization brought the illness, rebel vengeance brings the realness. Inflict damage on the cracker till the lungs are puffing shallow. We don't miss a single target when we aiming from the shadows.
Where you motherfuckers been? We on the front lines, walking with the dead. Where you motherfuckers been? We on the front lines, walking with the dead. Kill them all. Kill them all. Kill them all. Kill them all. Kill them all.
Have to unmute myself. This particular video to me is what Frantz Fanon has called combat literature. Right? I think that's important to acknowledge. And so you saw the children with the gun, the rifles, and this is why Vice called me. And then I responded, I was like, well, what about the violence of settler colonialism? I mean, I think we sort of undersell the violence of everyday and larger issues around colonization that have been happening for centuries. And, you know, one of the things that we that often gets ignored within indigenous hip hop circles when people are talking about it, they talk about people are talking about the struggle and their inner demons that they overcome. But people rarely bring up Savage Fam. And I mentioned them in a particular article I wrote for The Source, and I got a message from them. They're like, yo, thanks for giving us a shout out. And I was like, no, like, I've been following you all for years. Like, what's, it's not a big deal. But they're just saying a lot of people don't like to mention them. And this shows me the sort of a liberal analysis within even what we might call indigenous hip hop studies or indigenous popular cultural studies. Like, you know, what Alas mentioned, she said, none of us can be free on stolen land or some version of that. I'm paraphrasing, right? It is a real question. You think of the South Africa case a few years ago, and social media is blowing up when they wanted land back from the white Afrikaners. And it's like, what is their land? I mean, imagine telling someone that they should not get their land back after he stole it and colonized them and then created apartheid and segregated them. And we know the consequences that remain in South Africa. So I think sovereignty also exists for Native folks through popular culture and sonically as well. So I'm sure many of you know my colleague at UCLA, Shauna Redmond, fantastic person and scholar. She says here, music functions as a method of rebellion, a revolution in future visions that disrupt and challenge the manufactured differences used to dismiss, detain, and destroy communities, right? And I think there's some fantastic work that Native artists use, especially in showing solidarity with African Americans, especially in a place that I'm very familiar with in Detroit, Michigan. So I want to play this particular video about Southie. So Southie's from Southwest Detroit, Anishinaabe. Small info, he went to my aunt's school. So my aunt founded Medicine Bear American Indian Academy, which was the third ever public school founded with a Native American curriculum in the 90s. But if you know, it's Detroit, so you have also Black, you have multi-tribal students going to a school like that.
Work, then poison for breakfast, disrespecting myself like I had a death wish. Pain that I released, same pain that I was met with. Right, what's back. The point of happiness? My happiness was reckless. I was known commonly, drinking get ornery. TikTok and bombing me, I brushed it off comically. I was trying to fill a hole, maybe take the scars away. Rap out what I know, and the lavish life is far away. Alley filled with rats and roaches and glass smokers. Kids play on bikes, next moment they mad soldiers. Joy for the hungry when they got a spoon eating. Yeah. And it's joy for the fiend when they see the spoon eating. Damn. Lost, brainwashed, congregation is the quiet sin. Your donation got the pastor getting finer things. I lose my mind trying to figure it out. And the truth is hard to find when you living in doubt. Let's go. No, I just want joy for me. And I just want joy for you. Nah, nah. And the ones that got here for me. See, I want joy for you too. Cause I know, life gets hard. 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 Life is hard, said the man with the three-car garage and the family van. So it's hard to the single mother, gotta be the father too, and plus the handyman. Life is hard, said the man, I gotta decide to pay with credit cards or his cash hands. So it's hard to the man, I gotta find his dinner every night, digging in the trash can. What's joy to the big oil CEO that sleeps very well at night and keeps bleeding the pole? Let's knock that door down. Let's knock that door down. Knock that door down. Let's knock that door down. I'm starting to gain perspective. I'm watching my perception. I'm feeling my redemption. I'm starting to feel some tension. I like to save protection. I roll one with perfection. Zone. And then I go into my own dimension. No, I just want joy for me. And I just want joy for you. Nah, nah. And the ones that got here for me. See, I want joy for you too. Cause I know life gets hard. 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 But I'm joy for the children in the Middle East. Joy for the boarding school student and the evil priest. Or for the crime mother with a son in the street. On a cold night, he took a hot one from the police. No joy when the greedy getting greedier. Armies get deployed, propaganda in the media. FDA approved, GMO is what they feeding ya. Trade'll get you die, ain't nobody here defeating us. I found joy in camaraderie at Standing Rock. In Detroit, screams go silent on the abandoned block.
Where's the joy for the veteran with PTSD? Come home, get no love from his own country. The land of the free, the home of the brave. But we mascots with redskins and Indians and braids. I wear my hair long and I twist it up in braids. Hope you ready for this motherfucking wave. No, I just want joy for me, and I just want joy for you, nah, nah. And the ones that got here for me, see, I want joy for you too. Cause I know, life gets hard, I know, life gets hard. I know, life gets hard, I know, life gets hard.
So what I especially enjoy about Southie in particular, so he also has a track, Pay to Be Poisoned, which is about the Flint water crisis. And when you find Native people, especially in urban contexts, you grow up in a place like Detroit, you have these cultural elements of Blackness, linguistically, stylistically, you grow up around Black people, those are your friends, family, etc. Right? And so something like water, the water shutoffs of Detroit, the Flint water crisis, become meaningful to them. Because yes, it is about water, it is indigenous land, but those are also their people. And this is also how you demonstrate solidarity. You talk about issues that impact your people. Which is why I appreciate someone like Southie. And he's also just very explicitly and importantly anti-capitalist. And if you listen to the track, if not, go ahead and listen to it again on your own time. It's talking about CEOs, who's responsible for the poverty of certain communities and who's able to sleep better at night. So this is why I appreciate the work of these Native artists. And for time's sake, I'm gonna skip through this other song. So I think one of the important parts of indigenous hip hop too are indigenous femcees, indigenous women rapping about their own particular issues, causes, etc. But as Leanne Simpson, the quote on the left tells us, centering the voices of children, women, and Two-Spirit queer people within the Radical Resurgence Project is a mechanism through which to counter the gendered nature of heteropatriarchy and build systems of consent, accountability, and agency so that all indigenous political orders are valued, cherished, and celebrated as a crucial part of our communities and nations and fully engaged in the regeneration of alternative indigenous worlds. And I think, and certainly, that Native women, especially rappers and also other forms of cultural producers, are doing just that. So I'm gonna play this particular video by Equal, who I call a indigenous hip hop OG. Like, she's been in the game in Canada for a long time, but has been producing work for well over 20 years, I think. And T-Rhyme has been on the scene for like a good 8 to 10 years or so. But what are they rapping about, right? So in the context, and you see some of the information I have here, in 2016, the Urban Indian Health Institute, they found that there are 5,712 reports of missing indigenous women and girls. And the US Justice Department only logged 116 cases. Now, mind you, this work is important because while they can find some, although not enough, information around issues around violence that happens against indigenous women on the reservation, these statistics are much more difficult to gather in urban context. And there's a host of reasons for that. One, some people may not be classified as indigenous because of how they look. Maybe they look Black, maybe they look white, right? The other thing is, and which is ironic because at least 70%, if not more, of indigenous peoples live in some urban context. Also, some might not be enrolled even if they are identified as such. But you have to understand in urban communities, enrollment doesn't necessarily always mean the same things in that particular environment. Like you might have family. And the other thing is, especially in a place like Detroit or other places that are close to the Canadian border, and certainly, of course, Indigenous people coming from Central and South America, they might live in a different nation state. And we can talk a lot about how their forms of indigeneity become erased there. But I think people like Equal and T-Rhyme are doing a lot of important work here in celebrating Indigenous feminism. Let me try that again. Good. All right, let me make sure y'all can see the slides this time. My bad for that. All right, we're good? All right, my bad. So the study was from 71 cities, just to be clear about that. And so I can send this slide to Susan and Kalani too. So if there are people that want it, they can send it to you. But what I like about this particular video is also the expression of indigenous feminism. You had indigenous women from different ages, different body types, different aesthetics, and they were celebrating themselves, right? Without a quote I thought about putting here with from Leanne Simpson was, she makes a point to say, like, I want indigenous men to sort of smash patriarchy and support us, but I don't need them. I just want them to support us, because you can't have everyone in a nation without cisgender men such as myself, like, doing our part to make sure we deal with our own forms of trauma and also not perform abuse, etc., and conduct forms of abuse, etc. So I'll conclude here. I think where we should be going is toward an Indian popular cultural criticism. And I say this to say, not everything that Native peoples produce is good, right? Of course, the meaning of good is subjective, right? But there is a sort of element that you're trying to support people. But just like in we might say African American hip hop, like, there's some trash out there that's just not good, and we talk about it. But there's not that same sort of energy, and I understand why. It's like there's not a certain visibility, et cetera. So you don't want to, and you also don't want to call him as a hater. But I do think that we need forms of popular culture criticism. Again, that's a structural analysis of the form and the mode of the popular culture, right? So I certainly think we should do that. And the other thing that is happening that I tried to show, that there is forms of solidarity of people of African descent. That is certainly happening. And I would love to see different connections, say, between indigenous peoples in the US and North America and South Africa, for example, right? We often erase within indigenous studies, Africa as a place with many forms of indigenous peoples, as just one example. Indian popular culture sort of narrativizing the future of our freedom, and the explicit anti-colonial politics that these artists, creators are trying to express. And I love and appreciate that. I saw it in there and looking forward to the Q&A. Thank you so much.
Great, so we have some time for your questions. I've got my participants list up here. Kyle, I don't know if you can see that as well. How would you like to handle, how would you like to moderate Q&A?
I guess people can put them in the chat or just
chat, or we can let people raise their hands and ask.
Or people can raise your hand, yeah.
I think Sam.
I just had one quick question. You mentioned cultural sovereignty. And one thing is, how can that be / how is it defended? And so cultural sovereignty is, as I heard it, is keeping a culture separate from this kind of globalization of commodities and whatnot.
I think I missed a little bit of the first part, but if I'm understanding your question, how do you kind of keep it, I guess, if not kind of...
How do you defend cultural sovereignty? How can you keep those cultures separate when they're constantly mixing together?
Yeah. Well, one, I think popular culture is something, even indigenous popular culture, that you want to share with a variety of people. I don't see anything wrong with it. And although I might have criticisms of certain forms of cultural production and within political economy, it is meant to share a beautiful sets of cultures, peoples, and what they're expressing. And I think any forms of culture are meant to express the human self, essentially. Now, especially the sovereignty, like we have to go back to what particular tribal nations want. And how they're defending land, their people, and taking care of those people. So I think it's not really about protecting that. And I don't even know how one can do that in this particular capitalist system. Because, for instance, once you put something on YouTube, it's out there. Once you put something on Spotify, it's kind of out there. And frankly, stealing from Native people, stealing from Black people, culturally speaking, and of course there are other material things, is as American as cherry pie, to paraphrase something from way back in the day. So there's no protecting it until there's, we're in the this aftermath, I like to call it settler colonialism.
Yes, hi, thank you, Kyle, for that really awesome talk. And I just wanted to engage you. I do have a question, but I wanted to mm-hmm. kind of just say what seemed to be a theme throughout your talk and kind of your analysis of the music that you shared was this tension between, well, so much really, but participation in and critique of, and even, you know, going further, mm-hmm. resistance to. So we talk about, you know, the market economy, colonial, settler colonial system or structure. And then even in the, as in the last question by Sam, you know, sharing and celebrating versus, you know, theft, stealing or protecting, you know, that tension there. And so I just kind of wanted to kind of, you know, highlight that as a takeaway that I have. And as well as like thinking about, you know, what it, the presentation of the music, the videos, the imagery as a, as something profoundly raging against a violence that is attempting to project itself as a peacefulness, you know? Mm-hmm. And so that, that kind of flipping things around of, you know, the projected peacefulness, for example, of settler colonialism, but it's created through violence. And so I just, you know, that that's another takeaway, a reflection from your talk. I wanted to ask you, you know, engaging with Leanne Simpson's work around resurgence, which I think is really amazing and beautiful and respect the work that she does both through her scholarship and through land-based forms of resurgence that she promotes and teaches and is a part of. But for you, this question specifically is kind of how do you envision through your work and through kind of your roots, really, resurgence, indigenous resurgence from an urban perspective, you know? What does that mean through the types of cultural productions that you are working with, you know, specifically in these very, you know, urban-based performances and works like Sophie that you brought up?
Yeah, and I think, and I'm sure Knox, Sacramento Knox would deal with this, but what I sort of envision is how do we get these sort of communities together and whether that's in a particular space and imagining this world outside of white supremacy and settler colonialism. I often think to myself, and this is, I'm gonna return to Leanne Simpson, like in the aftermath of Mike Brown's murderers not being indicted, and I, as someone like still learning about abolition, I'm not convinced of prisons anyways, but she said it's my job as an indigenous person to make room on my land for Black people and amplify Black voices. And I think she and I would agree with other sorts of voices too, right? But like what kind of agreements can, new agreements, you can call them treaties, whatever, what kind of new agreements, treaties can Native nations, whatever their protocols are, and wherever their, you know, historical traditional territories exist, whether they're on them or not, how can they make agreements with people of African descent, especially the those forced to the U.S. because of neoliberal policies, and of course the enslaved peoples? And to me, that's a question that we deeply need to engage with collectively. And in the meantime, in urban contexts, like trying to create certain spaces. So in Chicago, it's sort of an immediate thing, but there's a particular alderman, and there's a lot of like indigenous peoples from Central America and South America who live in this area. I think Albany Park in Chicago. And this alderman sort of just, there was a vacant lot in Chicago, and is like, let's create some sort of space, a cultural space for indigenous youth. And for them to be able to kind of use it is how they see fit. And in the meantime, I think those are some very practical things we could find and figure out and how to do. And for the, you know, Black celebrity class, indigenous celebrity class, if you will, who have a couple of Dallas in their name, give it up. And you'll get a nice tax break. We know how this works. Like, create some spaces for these young people to collaborate, learn each other's histories, and let them imagine this new world for us, and get our elders together too. I'm sorry to be long-winded about this, but I believe thoroughly in this. Like, we need to really get our elders in these conversations who may not have had a chance to talk, and like, what was it like growing up, say in the 1930s and 40s, right? And what world did you want to see or want to build? Because we're not gonna, we can always focus on the youth, but we're not going anywhere without the knowledge of our elders as well. So I would love to just sit at the feet of our elders sharing stories about and what kind of world that they want to see as well. Thank you for that.
Cheryl?
Thank you. So, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you so much for that amazing presentation. I just learned so much. My question was, if you could speak a little more about how some of the artists that you study are decolonizing hip hop through their lyrics and their videos, and then also through the industry practices of recording and producing, you know, circulation.
Well, first of all, if this is the same, Cheryl, I love your book. I remember reading it years ago, so I just absolutely love the book, so thank you. So I love that book. Anyways, so, some of the practices that I think people are doing, the one thing I did not mention and maybe is not as clear, is many of these artists are actually activists in their own right. Especially so, and many of them also work with young people. So they're not only recording, and it's, you know, some of them have dreams of kind of making it big, but they're also not naive to how Native people are treated in popular culture, even by African-Americans. I don't want to romanticize within hip hop, romanticize things like that. And so what they do is they end up creating websites and are selling merchandise, try to do speaking engagements. So whenever there's a certain thing, I try to put people on in a certain way. And also working in the community. So in doing a lot of youth cultural work is one way that they try to pass on knowledge. So in many urban contexts, they be in some ways become, for lack of a better way of saying it, some sort of middle-aged elders, if you will, for young people who, for a host of reasons, maybe they're not as connected with certain with their tribal nation or communities. And, you know, there's a host of reasons that happen to young people of color in urban contexts. So they end up gravitating towards some of these older hip hop heads. But people still try to produce their work on Spotify and those different curated spaces. But there's a lot of things that they try to do in that regard. And just try to educate young people in a certain way. So for them, I would say they try to produce what I like to call indigenous modernity for young people.
Awesome, awesome. That was an amazing presentation. I just want to say appreciate you weaving through all of those artists and really bringing up misogyny, class, and really tying it to, you know, major important themes. I wanted to go back to one group that you played, the Savage Fam, which really struck me at, you know, with the imagery, but even also with their name, you know, and using that name, Savage, which, you know, really, I mean, in interesting ways, I think, could be thought of as a reclamation of a word that was, you know, used to dehumanize, you know, Native people, Indigenous people, et cetera. And so I just wanted to, you know, it was also making me think of, you know, there's artists, and, you know, Black artists that have also started using that word in particular, 21 Savage being a, you know, very prominent hip hop artist now. And you know, what some folks don't know about 21 Savage is he, you know, grew up in an Ifa, in a house that practiced the Ifa religion, goes back to African traditional Nigerian and Yoruba faith. And so I just wanted to hear, you know, from your perspective, you know, what is this act of reclamation? Is that what I'm actually seeing? How do you think about you know, hip hop as that sort of that force of reclamation?
It is, and I'm sure you've seen this. There's a lot of young people who use the word savage, and I always hear people, especially older folks. Not that anyone in this conversation is old, by the way. Hating on the young people for using semantic inversion, as they would say in linguistics, or that is flipping the word to mean something different, or as you said, Connie, reclaiming a certain word. And so we know from the history of Native people and how they're treated in society by Europeans, they were called, you know, savage, certainly in French and English, et cetera, to what dehumanize them in order to do what, take land. Right, and also other epithets, the S word, as we'll say, directed towards Indigenous women, which still exists. But there's are some around young people, they might reclaim certain words. So to me, it's semantic inversion, but especially in the context of Savage Fam, it's really to say, like, I will show you a savage. Right, it's a very direct confrontational form of semantic inversion. Like, I am a product of this savage, as Clint was saying, savagely violent form of colonialism. I am a product of that. I am a product of what you produce. And in order to get my freedom, I'm going to act in a way that you deem is unnecessary. You should be nonviolent. You should not disrupt certain things. And it's like, all right, I'm going to act like a savage. So it's certainly a form of reclamation, which I love about their work. It's right to the point. There's no compromise about what they're saying. So I'm a huge fan of what they're doing and doing that sort of work. And back to Cheryl's point, that's decolonization in the classic sort of Fanonian sense, if we will.
I have a question, actually, and I was wondering, in terms of sort of dissemination of music, is this primarily an internet-driven dissemination process, or is there a live music circuit that these artists are also earning a living through, or is it primarily electronic? And I'm asking, especially because I'm thinking about sort of the politics, right, of using YouTube and other kinds of electronic platforms as these sort of deterritorialized platforms, right, that can connect artists and communities and can infiltrate in maybe some unexpected ways. So I'm wondering if you, both of those things, the first, what's the sort of political economy of the practice? And then the other is, have you theorized at all what it means to have so much of this happening on YouTube?
Yeah, so people, they'll be on res shows and sort of smaller circuits. So maybe there's a festival in a particular city or a border town or some version of a festival. I've known people, I think my first night after moving to LA, there's this huge indigenous musical performance, and it was like five indigenous hip hop artists that I have been studying for a long time. And I just, I think someone told me like, yo, you're moving to LA, check out this thing. And it was right downtown in Grant Park. So I was lucky to see that and just surprised, and not that they're artists, but, and y'all know, like, Native artists don't even get certain forms of play, even in festivals, and especially in urban context. So I was very glad to see that folks had put that together. But I haven't done much theorizing about what it means to be on YouTube. I will say that it is, although you lose some ownership, I think it can offer more exposure for certain groups. So it's very limited a certain way. And if you even look at the views of some artists, some of their videos are like sky high, and then some are just on the lower end. Right. So for the visual sake, especially for young people, like, I encourage, you know, folks, if they have the capacity to do so. And increasingly, you can use even a phone or you don't need a lot to produce sort of like decent quality videos, which I appreciate, because, of course, they're not getting, you know, large advances and thousands of dollars to produce. And not that any of these thousands of dollars or $1 million put into some of these videos are good from what we might call mainstream hip hop. But I appreciate the ingenuity and creativity. And it's kind of akin to early forms of hip hop in some ways. Like, some videos are better than others, the quality. Some of the lyricism is better than others. But I love all of it because it's still like, it reminds me of that, or the original production that people are really trying to get across and express themselves.
Final questions. We've got a few minutes left. I think I'm going to thank you so much for sharing this amazing talk with us tonight and this fantastic music. And I'll add our clappy hands. And it's just really wonderful to have you. Thank you so much for coming and sharing with us.
Thank you. I really appreciate you bearing with me even over Zoom.
Thanks so much.